I think it just must have been incredibly exciting. Something very, very special.
You'll find it worthwhile if you roll out of bed with a smile.
This is Radio Butlin calling all campers. Good morning, everyone. This is one of your resident announcers, Joy Leggett, telling you that the time is just after 7:45. It's a lovely morning and it's time to get up. We do hope you all have a really happy day in store for you.
Butlins was introduced as a place for working class families to have a decent holiday.
Will Mrs. Roberts please go to Shelley C16, South Kemp, where her baby is crying and the tears are coming out under the door.
You get these amazing images of the chalets, the old chalets, of which there are hardly any left. People doing various group exercise activities, people on bicycles, sort of happy family type holiday images. This is a private space that I've gone into, owned by a private company who were obviously keen to represent themselves in a very particular way. So that has been a difficult process, in a sense, both for me and for Butlins. In a sense, I think they've been very brave to let someone like me in to go and photograph the place. It's not about rushing in there, you know, getting the shot in an hour and rushing out again. It's about thinking, exploring, working out how you want to do things. And one of the key influences in how I formed the way I was going to do it was through looking at the John Hind photographs from the 1960s. The John Hind studio was a commercial photography studio, and there's a particular kind of glamour to these images. They're very vivid colour, they're very staged, and they're very beautiful. And they capitalise on this idea of a fabulous fabrication, which is what Butlins is in a sense. And so I was looking for that when I went around, and in fact it was quite hard to find these kind of spaces that John Hind had photographed, but after I looked for a while I could find them. And so I concentrated on the idea that I was not remaking those images, but trying to make a modern version of them. I photographed in a similar kind of manner. So I used a large format camera, a lighting crew. I had a team of assistants. The glamour that seems present in the modern pictures that's echoing the 50s and 60s doesn't seem to be present in the older archive images. The table setups and layouts and social areas seem, if you like, more sensible, more practically orientated. The whole process of making the images is very much a staged affair. There are several toddlers' play areas, and I particularly like this one because of the bright, vivid yellow and the reds and the pink, so visually it's great. We've had to talk to all the people in the space and wait for people to come and go, talk to them as they're coming in and out, tell them what we're doing, tell them what the project's about. Essentially, I much prefer the kind of colour and depth that you get with the 5:4 film. The colour is just totally different. Everything within the frame of what we call documentary is, in a sense, artificial. As soon as you put that rectangle or square round the image, you've cut something out. It's part of the documentary process, and it should be understood as that.
Elaine, how old's Elaine?
Six and three quarters.
Six and three quarters? Which part is the three quarters? That part up there, I see. Okay.
Just as in the archive pictures, I feel that people are interested in the idea that they have been part of this process of making a historical document. You need them to have some kind of understanding of that to make it work.